WERQ-FM, HD3 Baltimore, celebrating Radio 1's 42nd anniversary.
Our Radio 1 family, our employees, their family members, our listeners, our viewers, our extended family.
And serving the African-American community for over 42 years.
The views and opinions of the guest and host you hear on 1010 WOLB
are not necessarily those of the staff and management of Radio 1, its sponsors, or advertisers.
Hello. Hello, hello, hello. Every Friday from 10 to 12 here on 1010 WOLB is the Frank M. Conaway Sr. et al. Show with co-host attorney Tehma Smith Wilson.
Good morning, Baltimore. Glad to be here with you today. Today is the last Friday of the first month of 2023. I hope it's been very productive. I'm an attorney and business owner in Baltimore City, and the services that I offer include real estate and estate planning. So if you need to buy or sell your property or to purchase your ground rent or update your deed, please give us a call at 667-334-7242. 667-334-7242. And also, if you want to join the conversation via text during these next 2 hours, please feel free to text me any questions or comments that you have, and we'll be sure to include them in the conversation. 667-334-7242.
All righty. Anything on your mind today?
We have a lot of great topics coming up. And in our first segment, news you can use or information for dissemination, we have someone from Civic Works, Miss April Peterson. So get your pen, get your paper. The information she give out will be worth writing down.
All righty. In fact, everybody you've been bringing on here, bringing some good information, I can tell you that. And our other co-host, attorney Robert Bob the Dean Dashiell.
Good morning again, Baltimore. Happy and blessed to be here. Really too blessed to be stressed by anything that's going on. I appreciate the fact that I am here, and I'm a lawyer, as you know. My number is 410-547-8820. 410-547-8820 if you do business or want to do business with the government, particularly Baltimore City.
All righty. And yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas of the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA. If you need our services, the telephone number to call is 410-669-1738. That's 410-669-1738. Specializing in at-need, pre-need, pre-arrangements, seminars, veteran benefits. Veterans, please get your DD-214, cremations, and you know the drill. Everybody need to get some insurance or increase what you got. So Aunt Sally won't have to give up her rent money and the car money to help y'all bury somebody. Okay? Oh, nah. There is a lot to talk about today, but as you heard Tehma say, we have a special guest who we want to get in. This station, which was founded by the great Dr. Kathy Hughes, was founded for our community. And in keeping with her tradition, we try to bring you information because information is power. I'm telling you, these last several weeks of information to folks, or not be nobody out there looking for a job after the last couple folks we had on here in the last couple weeks. Because truly, it was explained to you that you can get an internship while being paid. And then after you have finished your apprenticeship, there's just about a guaranteed job for you. So there is no excuse, in my opinion, what's going on that you should be without a job unless you just lazy and don't want to be working. Now, I said it. There it is. Okay. Tehma, you want to introduce our guest that's on the phone, and we can get started.
One of the hot topics that we go over weekly is the increasing price of our water bill and our utility bills, which also includes electricity. And I know it might be a while, or it may or may not happen, where the city or the company lowers your bill or make it more cost efficient for you. But there are things that you can do on your own, things you can do now to help lower your utility bill, make your home more comfy, and improve the air quality of your home. The program that we're getting ready to go over, I knew it was in effect years ago. I did not know it was still taking place today, but this is a way that you could cut down on your utility bills and make your house more energy efficient. Today we have with us Miss April Patterson, who is the community outreach coordinator at Civic Works. This is her position. She's going to give us a lot of information about their energy program, number one, their career training program, number two, and their food box distribution program for seniors, which will start taking place this summer. Ms. Patterson?
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. Good morning, Baltimore. I thank you for your time and attention, and I wanted to share some information with you all this morning about our programs that are really targeted to help Baltimore communities. If you don't know about Civic Works, we've been around since 1994, and our main goal is to help strengthen Baltimore communities through skill development, education, and community service. So the two components I'm going to talk to you about this morning is basically around education and our community service. Our first program that I want to talk to you about this morning is our energy saving program. And then I'm going to share some information with you about our job training, job placement program. And then lastly, give you some information about how you can gain access to some healthy food boxes starting this spring. So our energy efficiency program consists of two tiers. The first tier is what we call Project Light Bulb. And this is an opportunity for folks to receive energy-saving items installed in their home for free. It's not based on income, not based on address. You can be a homeowner or a renter. It doesn't matter. So through our Project Light Bulb home installation program, you're able to receive up to 15 LED light bulbs, new shower heads, handheld shower heads in all your bathrooms. You're able to receive faucet aerators for your kitchen and bathroom sinks in order to keep your water in one nice stream and keep it from splashing out all over the place, so you're able to kind of conserve water. You also receive power strip cords, and we also insulate your hot water heater pipes. So these are some great ways to try to upgrade your home and help you save on water as well as help you save on your utility bill. And as I said before, it's free for all Baltimore City residents, whether you are a renter or whether you are a homeowner. The second tier of our program is our home weatherization program. And this is a program that we really encourage people to be a part of. It is income-based, however. So in order to receive the program for free, you would definitely have to meet some income requirements. And I will share my information, my contact information at the end of my presentation in case you have any questions. But our weatherization program consists of a 2 to 3 hour on-site assessment. An energy advisor will come to your home and analyze, do an analyzation of all of your diagnostic equipment in your house. That includes like all of your refrigerator, all of your appliances. They will check to see if there's any air leakage in your home. They will check to see if there's insufficient insulation. They'll also check and do a health and wellness assessment to make sure there's not high levels of carbon monoxide, that there's no high levels of radon in your home. And they'll do what we call a blower door test to see where air is seeping in or out of your home. If you all have ever seen a spider web in your home, just to let you know, spiders make their webs where bugs come in. So that might be a place where you might need some air sealing and insulation done in your home. And so I just want to run over some really quick, fun facts. LED light bulbs, the one that we distribute in our Project Light Bulb program, last up to 9 years. Getting energy efficiency improvements to an already existing home allows you to get a tax credit. And so that's something to really think about as well. And also, if you have an HVA system in your house, HVAC system in your house, it's good to change those filters every 3 months and not the usual 6 months that a lot of people will tell you. So those are just some fun facts about your home that we like to share with folks. We want everybody in Baltimore to be more energy efficient and really help save on their utility bills. But not only that, we want to weatherize homes in order to keep unhealthy pollutants out of your home in case you have folks that live in your home that might have underlying health issues. So those things are very important as well. And so we have created this reinvestment model within our organization because the folks that do the weatherization on homes come through our job training, job placement program. We have 3 tracks in that program, weatherization, solar installation, and utility infrastructure. The training is classroom-based for about 6 weeks. During that time, the participants receive a weekly stipend. And then they go on to an on-the-job training component, which is about 4 to 6 weeks, and they receive an hourly wage when they're on the on-the-job training component. We are definitely vested in success. The only requirements for this program is to be 18 years or older and a Baltimore City resident. So far, our placement rate is about 88%. And our retention rate is about 75%. And then the average wage after graduating from the program is $17.75 an hour, which is, we're trying to create not just jobs, but family sustaining careers. So that's a great opportunity for folks. If you're interested in that program, there is an open house every Tuesday at 1 p.m. And I do believe it's virtual still, but you can call 410-929-6120 if you're interested in that program. And lastly, we know that folks are still struggling with food insecurity. So we do have $5 food boxes that we will distribute to Baltimore City residents starting in March. The cost of the food box is $5, and you get fresh fruits and vegetables from our farm, and you're able to get those delivered to your door. So if you are interested, please call this number. It is 410-826-5955. And you can call Mondays, every Monday between 9 a.m. and 4 p.m. Now, this program doesn't start until March, but it's a great opportunity for folks who are 55 years and older to receive food. And I think that's basically all I had this morning. I welcome any questions that you might have. I know I don't have a whole lot of time, but are there any questions or anything that may have missed?
Yes, I have a couple of questions.
For
the home weatherization, is that for renters? I know that's income-based, but is that for renters and homeowners as well?
Yes, a renter is able to do home weatherization if they get the landlord's approval in writing. We have a very, one-page approval letter that we ask the homeowner to complete, and then we could move forward with the weatherization process.
And I know you're based out of Baltimore City, but are these services offered to other counties as well?
We are based out of Baltimore City. We cover the city, Baltimore County, Howard County, as well as Harford County.
And my last question is...
Now, the job training program is just for Baltimore City residents, as well as the food distribution program. That's just for Baltimore City residents.
And with the food distribution program, what is the frequency that seniors can order this food? Is it once a week, once a month, or however much they need, as long as they could pay?
They can order it once a week. It's once a week. They call on Monday, and then it's distributed that same Wednesday of that same week.
Thank you very much. You answered all my questions. Anyone else have any questions?
Bob, you got it?
No.
Ms. April?
Yes.
Carl Douglas here. I'd like for you to give those telephone numbers again to the listening audience. The 929 and the 826 again, in case they want to get in touch.
Actually, thank you for reminding me. I didn't give out my contact information. If you all are interested in the energy installs or the weatherization, again, my name is April Patterson, and my phone number is 410-929-6084. Or you can email me at apatterson@civicworks, and that's civicworks.com. And then the phone number for the food box program is 410-826-5955. And then the phone number to get in touch with the job training program is 410-929-6120.
Okay. Well, thank you, Ms. Patterson, for coming on and being such, I'm telling you, you gave some heck of information that I know.
I know that many of our listeners, I hope, will take heed to everything you told them. And those who need that help, we hope that they will call you. And that's what this show is about, giving out information and listen to other folks say what they got to say along with what we have to say. So we certainly want to thank Tehma again for having you to come on and let folks know out there. Now, this weatherization program has been out for a while. I remember when they first started this back years ago, because a whole lot of folks needed it.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
because because over 75% of homes in Baltimore City were built before 1958.
Right.
So that's why we just feel the need to try to help folks, save money on their utility bills with other costs going up, food prices, gas prices. So we want to be able to help and fill those critical service gaps that might exist in our community.
Well, we certainly thank you for coming on, and God bless you, and keep
God
on helping folks. All right.
Thank you so much. I appreciate your time. Take care.
All right. Thank you
as well.
Okay.
All right.
Let's get started here. We got two lines open. 410-481-1010. 410-481-1010. You better get in where you can fit in, because some of y'all wait till the last minute trying to get in. And when I tell you the lines are open, you hesitate to call. So we're telling you now, two lines open, 410-481-1010. WOLB streams live at WOLBBaltimore.com. WOLB streams live at WOLBBaltimore.com. That means if you can't hear us too well on the radio, you can get us through the internet that way. Okay? excuse me. Right now we got Bill, Leo, Melvin, and we got two lines open, but let me get started here. Locally, seems that the family of the late young lady who was allegedly murdered by Adnan Syed is complaining about how the deal with Adnan went down, and is asking that it be repealed. Now, the new state's attorney, Ivan Bates, has not made up a decision on how he's going to deal with this case yet. There's a ruling being waited upon by the Court of Appeals on what's going on. So we're going to have to wait and see what's going on with that. The Angelo's family is at it again. Look like it's total war going on within that family. In fact, yesterday, the Angelo's family okays a law firm deal, a conservator, to take over Pete Angelo's business in dispute. So since I'm bringing up that, and I got two lawyers here, and one of the deans is here, How does this thing work, Bob, on where Pete, of course, is ill to the point that he cannot no longer take care of any of his business or even, from what I hear, even his personal needs. And, of course, being one of the largest, if not the largest law firm in Baltimore with, I understand, some 20,000 clients. And a dispute going on within the family, of which I don't know if any of these parties, the two sons or the wife, are lawyers at all. How does this thing work here with the court naming a conservator to take over?
Well, here's what happened. One of the sons, transferred the law firm to himself. And I think one of the sons, who was either the court-appointed guardian for Mr. Angelos, transferred the law firm to himself and declared himself the owner of that business. But it's not one of the largest law firms, and most of the clients are class actions. But nevertheless, it over the years, it's made its money in asbestos litigation, for the most part. So the other family members, the other brothers, and I guess the wife as well, challenged that transfer of that asset. The law firm itself is an income producing asset because they still have lawyers, they're still settling cases, and they're still getting money in from cases they've already settled. Particularly, as I said, the asbestos cases. So they challenged the brother who said that he became the owner of the law firm. He transferred our law firm to himself. The court decided that the challengers to that action were correct, that the transfer of the law firm to the brother was unlawful, and that rather than doing that, the court appointed a conservator, which is in essence a receiver, somebody, an administrator, if you will, to oversee the operations of that law firm. Now, whether that means the law firm is going to be winding down and going out of business, or whether or not, at some point, the other litigation with the family members will be resolved and the law firm issue resolved as a part of that, I don't really know. But the decision that was just made was simply reversed the transfer of the ownership of the law firm from one of the children and basically put it in trust in the hands of the conservator.
Okay. We're up to about 22 homicides, and this is just the 27th day here in Baltimore. The other day, tragically, a 15-year-old Forest Park student was killed after he just got out of school. Now, anybody that's a parent must be concerned. You say goodbye to your son and daughter in the morning, send them off to school, and now you're in a position that you better be praying most of the day that they come home live, alive to you. Now, we don't know the circumstances of this case. I know the family is highly upset because of the way they had to find out whether this was their loved one or not. Now, they want to say that the school should have called them. The school is saying that it was really not up to them because they did not have a definite identification of the individual. It was up to law enforcement to find out what was going on. But just the fact that this gun situation getting in the hands of juveniles, if that's the case, because we don't know who shot this young man. But more and more guns are getting in the hands of juveniles, and they're using them. Question is, where are they coming from? One of the other things that you have to look at, be concerned about, of course, is what's going on down in Memphis, where five black police officers beat to death, allegedly, a young 29-year-old black man who was an employee, I believe, of FedEx, had a child. I understand that the video is so devastating, and it must be because the next day, the police department fired all five of them. Along with their two paramedics that had been put on leave. Now, they were not fired, but they were put on leave. I understand that today the video is going to be released. Those who have seen it are talking about how deplorable it is that everybody is getting upset and telling everybody to please be cool or control themselves when this video come out, because they don't want a riotous situation. And I'm talking about not only Memphis, they don't want a situation all over the country. So we're waiting to see. I wish I had a way. I'm going to try to get somebody to get the TV on for me and, you know, put it on mute, and I can watch CNN and see if when this thing comes across. The country of Germany has decided that they're going to give Ukraine tanks, forcing the United States, pressuring the United States to also do the same. And they have now come up and said, we will give the Abrams tanks, but they won't be there till the fall. Other European countries now are joining both Germany and the United States in saying they are also going to be sending tanks, which revved up the war with Ukraine and Russia. And Russia, of course, after hearing this, bombarded Ukraine with missiles again. Former Vice President Pence was found with confidential documents in his possession. Something is really wrong here. I don't know what's going on here.
Can we start with that one? Because what troubles me is people in the media try to equate or conflate what happened with Trump,
right,
with Biden and Pence.
It's not the same.
Neither Biden or Trump lied about having anything. Neither Biden nor Trump stole anything when they left office, because Biden continued in office. He went from vice president to vice president. And neither Biden or Trump or Pence, when they found out they had them, tried to conceal them and refused to give them back.
Right.
So there's neither one of those situations. And I don't know why the media tries to portray them as somewhat equal. But there's absolutely no similarity in those situations whatsoever. And we people who repeat them as though there is ought to stop that. Because just by continuing to repeat the story that way, you give the public the impression that it's all the same thing. It's all classified documents. They all had them. Classified documents are probably in the hands of everybody who's ever had access to them in one way or another.
Yeah.
People work from home. People work in their cars. People work in their shops. And I suppose they take an opportunity. They take the time to try to check. But who really checks?
I agree and disagree. In my opinion, it's not what you do with the documents after you get them. There's a serious breakdown with the federal government
in terms of how
in the world can 40 boxes of classified documents be unaccounted for or missing, and you don't know where they are, who are they with, and how to go and retrieve them.
And not just 40, any classified or top secret documents is supposed to be, first of all, you're supposed to be in a private room. If you're going to if you are cleared to read these documents and study them, you're supposed to be in a particular room doing this. And after you are finished, the documents are to be left there, and you walk the heck out, and whoever's in charge of the documents put them back where they're supposed to be. Now, how they got out of there?
Who's going to order the president to do that?
But here's the thing.
Well, that's the problem.
That's their job. The president didn't go and get those documents. Apparently, those documents were delivered to the president, and whoever delivered them should be responsible for taking them back to the government. I worked for a government contractor. I had a top secret clearance. We had classified documents everywhere. But the measures that they put on us apparently are more than the measures that they're putting on these elected officials. You know, not only were we responsible for the classified documents, but we will also get polygraphs on a regular basis just to make sure, you know, no, I don't have classified documents. No, they were not taken with me. No, you know, just to make sure that what we were doing fell in line with what we said we were doing in our actual actions.
Right.
So if Pence said, I have no knowledge of these classified documents, put him under a lie detector test, too.
Yeah.
See if he's telling the truth, if he's not telling the truth. But really, everyone, like you said, everyone probably has classified documents laying around somewhere.
Including some of them congressmen.
And they're in the hands of somebody who had the legal authority to declassify them.
Yep.
So the people who delivered them work for the same person who they delivered them to. So what are they going to do? Boss, I order you to give them back? Of course not. I mean, but that's why we get into all these tangential issues to distract attention from the real issue, which was Trump took stuff deliberately and tried to conceal, and his lawyers lied about it.
And I believe, and this is my belief, not Tehma's, not Bob's, not the station.
Okay.
I believe he's getting ready to sell them.
All right.
And use them in any way he could against anybody he perceived to have been an enemy, or any way he could have made some money. because Trump is about the dollar.
I believe anyone who gets caught with a classified document from this point and beyond, they set themselves up to be caught. Yeah, they've been on notice with Trump, Biden, Pence. So if you get caught now.
Okay, we're coming to the phones in this order. Bill, Leo, Melvin, Mike, and Rashid. In that order, Bill, Leo, Melvin, Mike, and Rashid. We're going to give you a minute and a half. Get your point in precisely, please. Be very mindful that somebody else is waiting for you to get off so they can get on, and a line will be open so someone else can call. Okay, and if you want to call, the number to call is 410-481-1010, 410-481-1010. Let's start out with Bill. You're on the air.
Hey, good morning to y'all. I'm talking about the classified documents. I just think that just goes to show how deep corruption is in our political system. But I just want to raise a couple questions. First, I just want to invite all black males onto our next breakfast, next Saturday, from 10 to 12:30 at Net Space, 112 East Lexington. Now, my question is this here, Carlton, on several levels. Last year, the legislators had an audit in reference to the drugs, weapons, and money missing from the police evidence rooms. Isn't it ironic that we have not heard nothing else about that situation or has been no other movement? That's number one. My other thing is that I heard recently on the news that now they're going to start billing us for our water digitally unless you call and say that you want your bill mailed to you by paper form, which I think going to pose another problem for a lot of us that's paying water bills and a lot of people that's not really up on technology, right? And last, I just want to ask these two questions. You know, we're paying for six different things in our water bill. Four of them I halfway understand because they can't explain themselves. But when we pay for sewer consumption, are they saying that based about how much water going to the sewer is what we paying for? And when they say storm water, are we paying for every time we have a storm or before we have a storm? Explain them charges to me.
I have no idea. Now, as far as the sewage is concerned, that might be because the sewage has to be treated, and that might incur the cost of it being treated. But the storm thing, I have no idea what that is about, because I was under the impression that the storm water is supposed to go back out into the Chesapeake Bay or something.
And that's
right.
And that's what the rainwater taxes,
right,
the Chesapeake Bay preservation,
right,
preservation function. Because when it rains, obviously the water goes into the same system that drains street drainage and so forth, and it ultimately flows back into the bay. And somebody's got to clean the bay up so that the oysters and fish and the natural habitat can survive. You're right, and Carlton is right. The sewage is treated at one of two places: that you've got either back river, a wastewater treatment plant, or Patapsco. Both of which have been under EPA consent decree since 2005 to modernize so that they can reduce the certain effluents going back into the navigable waters of the state. And Baltimore is way behind. In fact, you know that the Back River is still under state control from last year. So that's all taxpayer money. I mean, whether it's federal, it's all taxpayer money, and the money to pay for that has to come from somewhere, because the government doesn't have resources on its own, so it hires contractors to do that work.
Well, let me just close with this, and again, thank you. But you know, the Bay Restoration, I understand, but when they say sewer consumption, it sounds to me like water that's going to the sewer, where the sewer is consuming the water.
Well, it's not sewage consumption, it's sewage use, not consumption. It's water consumption.
And so last, I just want to say that also, you know, for the next couple years, then our bills is going to constantly go up. So I'm saying to everybody, continue to call City Hall, right? You know, I'm paying $122 a month right now, basically, with a single household. So I know some people's paying $300 and $400 a month when we used to pay $70 every 3 months. That's $300 extra every 3 months that I'm paying. So I'm saying we have to continue to call City Hall in numbers, and we have to flood them phones, because it's not that people can say, well, there's nothing we can do. Now, it's nothing we can do because we decide not to do nothing, right? When we decide to do something, then we can change some of the things happening to us. And it makes no sense for people not to be able to live into full water.
Thank you, Bill. Appreciate you, man. Let's go to Leo. We got a line open, 410-481-1010. 410-481-1010. Go ahead, Leo.
Good morning, Brother Carlton Douglas and distinguished attorneys. I simply want to make a quick announcement and a comment. The Roots of Scouting organization will be conducting or holding its annual African Heritage Honors Luncheon at the Forum Caterers on Primrose Avenue on Saturday, February 25th, from 1 to 4 p.m. It is a ticketed event, and we, at that time, we honor the achievements of youth and adults who distinguished themselves in service to our community. Roots of Scouting is in its 43rd year of service to our community and nation, and we ask your attendance. If you're interested in tickets, give us a call at 443-651-2578. I'll repeat that, 443-651-2578. And, of course, there's room for ads and patrons for our souvenir books, so give us a call. I just want to comment on the Memphis situation. It seems to me, and this is my subjective opinion, there's a lot of hype in promoting violence or the implementation of martial law. What am I saying? The officers were doing the bidding, the black officers of the white establishment, in my opinion. However, Joe Biden and all of the news media at this point in time are saying they're expecting riots to break out tonight or tomorrow. I don't think that's necessary. I think you need to keep the lid on. Mm-hmm. And when you say that, when you hype that kind of rhetoric, you're increasing the possibility of violence and the fact that people will implement martial law to suppress black folks in a very violent way. So I'm scratching my head and wondering why that is playing out the way that it is. And lastly, the mayor is talking about, and the police commissioner, getting guns off the street in Baltimore City. Well, what about the prosecution, and maybe the attorneys can speak to this, the prosecution of the manufacturers and distribution of ghost guns? They're claiming that 40% of the illegal guns being used in murders in Baltimore at this time are the result of 3D printer technology. Well, what's happening in that realm with regard to enforcement? Seemingly nothing is happening, and we need to be mindful of the games that are being played in that arena as well. What do you think about these ghost guns and the enforcement that surrounds that? I thank you.
Okay, Leo. Oh, Leo.
Yes.
Before you go, and brief, yes, and make it, please make it the answer brief, because I got a full line here.
Okay.
The Baltimore County Superintendent of Schools, Dr. Yes. Williams, has decided not to continue his contract. There was pressure put on him from everybody, including the Randallstown chapter of the NAACP.
That's right. Okay.
All right. If this man is being forced out, then why in the hell do we still have Santa Lisa's and nobody is forcing her out with the deplorable condition of the Baltimore City school system?
Well, of course, whether you agree with Darrell Williams or not, he was qualified to do the job. With regard to Santa Lisa's, that is part of the established order to maintain the status quo in Baltimore City public schools. With the Board of School Commissioners turning a blind eye and not caring and being controlled, the salary of Santa Lisa's continues to rise and the perks that she receives. and they're simply dumbing down our children. They don't teach cursive writing. They don't have, with regard to math and reading scores, we're the lowest in the state. We're in the bottom of the tank. And that seems to be the prevailing attitude. And the mayor continues to applaud what he says is a fine job on the part of the superintendent of Baltimore City Public Schools. Nothing could be further from the truth. We need to accelerate by litigation and demonstration our disapproval with the status quo here and the failure to hold our students to a standard of discipline and accountability.
Thank you, Leo. That's true
across the board.
Thank you, Leo. Appreciate you.
On the Memphis thing, I think that case, that situation presents many, many issues, and it's too easy to oversimplify it. I don't think it's just a matter of black cops carrying out, acting in a way to please their white handlers or their white masters. I think we've got a much deeper problem.
I do too.
I think you got a problem with boys with toys.
Yeah. Yeah, give them a gun and a badge.
You got a problem with boys with toys. Yep. And what that goes to, and that applies across racial lines. It goes to the psychological and emotional suitability of the people who we give weapons of mass destruction to. And we do. And the fact of the matter is, if we look at the process by which the people are evaluated for that purpose, and nobody can really read somebody's mind. You can't, but you can. If a person is raised a certain way, if they've lived a certain way, there's no use thinking they're going to change just because you put a uniform on them. And in fact, the chances are they're going to use the uniform, the badge, and the power to act the way that they live. So, anyway, I know callers are waiting.
Now, yeah. Before I go to Melvin, you and I are around the same age.
Yes.
The number one toy when we were coming up was a gun.
That's right. That's right. And it still is. Except now they're real.
Real.
The number one toy for boys is guns.
Yep.
And except now they're real.
Melvin, you're on air.
Great day, family. I have two questions for the two attorneys. To your knowledge, is it illegal to have a vehicle registered and insured in a different state?
Are you talking about a vehicle in this state registered and insured in another state?
Yes.
Do y'all know the answer to that?
I do, but I'm not here to give legal advice. I have an office number. If you want legal advice, call it.
Oh, okay.
Okay, and the second question, to your knowledge, is the decision of the Supreme Court of Maryland regarding the odor of cannabis being unconstitutional for the search of one vehicle, does that still stand?
Did y'all understand the question?
I don't know what decision he's talking about.
You wanna tell us what you're talking about, sir?
The decision of the Supreme Court of Maryland that found it unconstitutional for police officers to use the scent of cannabis to do a search of one's vehicle.
Oh, okay. Now, I did hear about that.
Do you think it's going to stand? Is that the question?
Is that the question, Melvin?
I'm asking, does that still stand? Does that decision still stand?
Yeah, it's still standing. They just made the decision.
And there's no Maryland court with a higher authority, so who would reverse it?
No, I was just asking because I had a situation with police officers who said that wasn't true.
No, well, tell the police officer he need to go check his laws out.
Yeah, I told him that, but that didn't play out in my favor on the streets.
Well, he didn't give you a hassle about it, did he?
Yes.
Well, then you need to get a lawyer, and you got two here.
That's why I called.
Yeah, well, they're not criminal lawyers now. They're business lawyers. So you might have to get a criminal lawyer if you got a real problem, okay?
Okay. Thanks very much.
You're more than welcome, Melvin. Okay, coming to Mike, Rashid, Chuck, and James. Okay, Mike, you're on air. Mike?
Good morning, Carlton, Mr. DeShields, Ms. Tehma. How y'all doing?
All right.
Good morning.
All right, Ms. Tehma, first I'm going to address you. I believe these classified documents, it was business as usual. That's why they all have them. because they've all sold them, and I don't have any definite proof, but I remember hearing something about it that one of these presidents used classified documents that were once classified that he declassified just before he left office to fund his library. So, and I believe other things are being done. This isn't, it's not happenstance that they find in the documents. They knew where to find them because all of them have done it, from Bush, from Obama, to Trump, to Biden, and the senators too. That's why they finding them, because they knew where to go look. And now, Carlton, I want to say this, and I'm going to get off the air. You had talked about how to do a cultural change. Now, yesterday on Larry the Cab Driver's show, a young rapper, a young man, he exemplified what you and I, and I've been talking about this for over 30 years now. It's a cultural change. We're all lambs. We follow trends. We have habits. And Mr. Dashiell and Ms. Tehma and Carlton, y'all all have businesses or in a business. And when you have to change your culture, you have to do a paradigm shift. And he said that you got to teach them through a trend, because one day at Mondawmin Mall in 1984, me and my cousin were sitting, and I said to him, man, we ought to invent a tennis shoe. And he said, we don't know nothing about no tennis shoe. I said, yeah, but it can be the ugliest tennis shoe, but if we take it around and give it to the 10 most popular people at high school, everybody will want one. And the change of paradigm shift, the best way to do it is painted as a teacher of what not to do. You fire some people. You got people coming back late. You got people who have attendance problems. Once you let them go, the rest will get in line. And he also said, we got to stop playing with these young people. We got to use some examples. And I'm going to say it again, and I've always said it. Pain is a teacher of what not to do. And because for some reason liberals have decided that, oh, they come from a broken family, they don't have this, they don't have that, that they can't be punished. And I said that we're going to ask for Martin O'Malley type of ruling before this whole thing is all said and done. When the people cry out and scream and say, we can't take it no more, then something will be done. But if I'm not the smartest person in the room, but if I thought damn near 30 years ago that you got to change the trend, you got to change the culture. We wore leaves. We wore screwdrivers. We wore Jack Marcells. We wore Kangos, mm-hmm. lambskin coats. It's all about trend. Y'all hang with people who do the same things you do. You don't hang with smoke crackers. You don't hang with whores. You don't hang with gamblers. I believe you don't. But those things are not... Those people who do those things, they don't want to hang with you.
Yeah, right. Thank you, Mike. Appreciate you.
Always.
All right,
always.
Man. Okay. Let me get Rashid first, because we're up against the hour here. Rashid, quickly.
Yeah, good morning, everyone. Speaking of schools, and, you know, did you know that they're shutting down 5 high schools for, you know, for renovation? They're shutting down City, Pauley, Western, Douglas High School, and Joseph Briscoe Academy, you know, for renovation. And what my sources tell me, so I asked them, well, where they going to put the students? And we have a couple vacant high schools around the city, so on a temporary basis, they're going to be relocated there. For example, a city is going to go down there off of Sinclair and Moravia, which used to be the old Howard Run Middle School. It's like a $400 million project they got going on.
Let us look into that, and we'll get back to you on that, okay?
Okay.
Thank you. Okay. Tehma, got a line open, 410-481-1010. Tehma.
Talking about changing the culture in the local and state news, Mr. State's Attorney Bates has a gun bill that he introduced out in Annapolis, and then today I think he's supposed to introduce it to the officials of Baltimore City. The gun bill is to target the mandatory minimums of illegal gun owners, and initially it wasn't getting too much traction, but the Republican delegate Nino Maggiani, he said that he would sponsor the bill. And Frank Conway said that he would support it if it was sponsored.
Frank Jr.
Yes. Frank Conway Jr. said he would sponsor it. So it'll be interesting to see what the outcome of that bill will be, who will sponsor it, who will not sponsor it and show its support, and see what kind of results it will bring in terms of changing the culture.
And this is, who's doing this now?
The state's attorney, Mr. Ivan
Bates. Mr. Ivan Bates.
Yes, okay. This is his first bill that he's proposing.
Well, what is this madness that Jill Scott coming up with about the juveniles? Are you two aware of this?
Which part?
I don't think it's madness. First of all, I think that Ivan so far, he's got to stop bending to political pressure, try to stop doing things because they appear to be politically correct. I mean, before there were mandatory sentences, there have been mandatory sentences for a long time. At 3 years for certain crimes, and obviously there's been no reduction because we've seen the murder rates go up constantly in spite of the mandatory. So changing from 3 to 5 years, in my opinion, won't do anything, but somebody will be talking about this 5 years from now sometime when I'm dead and gone. Hey, I think that...
Hold your point.
Go ahead.
Hold your point, because we're getting ready to go into the next hour. All right. And I said madness because the way I interpret it, what she wants to do is just slap these juveniles on the hand and just let them go.
I see it the same way.
And I ain't for that. If a kid got a gun and go out there and kill my kid, he needs to, if he did the crime, he need to pay the time. And that's what I'm talking about. I'll listen to your discussion about it when we come back.
Okey-dokey.
We're getting ready to go to the second hour of the Frank M. Conway Sr. at our show with co-host. Attorneys Tehma Smith Wilson, attorneys Robert Bob DeShields, and yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas. When we come back, we'll be coming to Chuck, James, Robert, I believe it's Sylvia, and Mark in that order. Okay, and when they get off, you can call in 410-481-1010. We get ready to go into the second hour. Don't you touch that dial. We'll be right back.
To keep them strong, moving in the right direction, living just enough for the city.
Talking the day, soul at night.